And if you go to Psalms number 69, Psalms number 69, and we're going to read together from verse 1 down to verse 21. Psalms and chapter number 69, and reading together from verse number 1. The psalm begins by saying, with the title, A Psalm of David. But as you read the psalm, it's quite clear that this is not just a psalm of David, but it's a psalm that is very much messianic in nature. It's talking so much about the Lord Jesus Christ. And we see things about Christ that are just so enlightening for us as we consider all that Christ has done for us at Calvary. So, Psalm 69, verse 1. Save me, O God, for the waters are come in unto my soul. I sink in deep mire, where there is no standing. I am coming to deep waters, where the floods overflow me. I am weary of my crying, my throat is dried, my eyes fail while I wait for my God. They that hate me without a cause are more than the hairs of mine head. They that would destroy me, being mine enemies wrongfully, are mighty. Then I restored that which I took not away. O God, thou knowest my foolishness, and my sins are not hid from thee. Let not them that wait on thee, O Lord God of hosts, be ashamed for thy sake. Let not those that seek thee be confounded for my sake, O God of Israel. Because for thy sake I have borne reproach, shame hath covered my face. I become a stranger unto my brethren, and an alien unto my mother's children. For the zeal of mine house hath eaten me up, and the reproaches of them that reproach thee are fallen upon me. When I wept and chastened my soul with fasting, that was to my reproach. I made sackcloth also my garment, and I became a proverb to them. They that sit in the gate speak against me, and I was the song of the drunkards. But as for me, my prayer is unto thee, O Lord, in an acceptable time, O God, in the multitude of thy mercy, hear me in the truth of thy salvation. Deliver me out of the mire, let me not sink. Let me be delivered from them that hate me, and out of the deep waters. Let not the water flood overflow me, neither let the deep swallow me up, and let not the pit shut her mouth upon me. Hear me, O Lord, for thy loving kindness is good. Turn unto me according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, and hide not thy face from thy servant, for I am in trouble. Hear me speedily. Draw nigh unto my soul and redeem it. Deliver me because of mine enemies. Thou hast known my reproach and my shame and my dishonor. Mine adversaries are all before thee. Reproach hath broken my heart, and I am full of heaviness. And I look for some to take pity, but there was none. And for comforters, but I found none. They gave me also gall for my meat, and in my thirst they gave me vinegar to drink. We find in this psalm five times where the word reproach is used. In verse 7, David says, I've borne reproach. In verse 9, he says, the reproaches of them that reproach thee are fallen upon me. In verse 10, he says, that was to my reproach. Verse 19, thou hast known my reproach. And then in verse 20, he says, reproach hath broken my heart. You think about that word reproach. It's quite an interesting word in relation to our Saviour. And I want to speak to you tonight on the subject of what verse 20 tells us, that reproach hath broken my heart. Now, when you think about the aspect of being reproached, it's something that is quite interesting when it is referred to Christ. Because when we think of Calvary, I think we're all here tonight quite familiar with the concept that he who knew no sin became sin for us. We understood that he bore our sins, he became sin for us, he paid the penalty for our sin in full, And we look at our Saviour, and of course there's no doubt in our minds, we know that he was absolutely innocent. He was the sinless and the spotless Lamb of God. But when our Lord went to Calvary, and as he had been whipped, and as he carries his cross up to Golgotha, we know that one Simon is compelled to help him to bear the cross as he staggers under the load. He's been humiliated, he's been spit upon, he's been cursed, and eventually, of course, the nails are driven into his hands and into his feet. He is hanging upon the cross and becoming sin for us. And the people that looked upon him, apart from the disciples, and apart from the woman that faithfully followed him, and apart from his mother, they all understood that he was innocent. But everyone else looked upon Jesus Christ as being a wicked individual. They saw him as somebody that was bearing reproach. And you know, in all of the time that he endured all of this, he didn't say, well, it's not me. It's not that I haven't done anything wrong. He wasn't saying, you know, I'm dying for the sins of the world. You don't understand. He didn't say anything quite like that. No, we read that, you know, just like a lamb is dumb as it faces death, so our Lord did not open his mouth. He just took the shame and he took the reproach. Sometimes, I've used this illustration, I'm sure you may have heard something similar, where there may be like a courtroom, and a man is standing before the judge, and he is obviously guilty for a particular crime. And then the judge hears the facts of the case, guilt is pronounced, and then he gets to the place where he's about to pass down judgment upon the individual. And then he takes off his judge's gown, he gets off the judge's chair, and he goes and he stands where the condemned man stands, and he says, I'll take the price and pay the price in full. And while that may not necessarily work in a proper court of law, we use that to illustrate just what Christ has done for us, how that God has condemned us, showing us that we're absolutely sinful and guilty and deserve to go to hell. As judge, that is quite definite. And then what God has done is that he's come to where we stood before him as a judge, as condemned, and he took our place. But if you just give me the leeway and just think about this judge for a minute, and there he is, he's taken off his gown, and he's standing before his own court and saying, I'm going to take the price in full. People that would look on in such a case would say, isn't that a great judge? They would say, he didn't do it, but look, he's willing to pay the price. He's paying the fine or spending time in jail, whatever the case may be. But he's so magnanimous because he didn't do this. And can you see what the judge is doing? He's taking the place of the sinful individual. But this judge is such a wonderful individual in that he took the place willingly. But you know, when Christ went to the cross, people didn't look upon him in such a way. They didn't say, look how great he is. They didn't say, he's taken our place. Isn't it wonderful? They just spat upon him. And they just ripped his beard from his face. So, you know, when we think about the cross, we tend to think in terms of the visual pain and suffering that a person would endure. And, you know, there may be some pictures that you would have seen and are drawn to your attention, and you think to yourself as to how cruel and how awful a death that must have been. But I do think that the sufferings of our Saviour upon the cross were so much more than what you and I could visualize with our eye. I think the sufferings of our Saviour were such where the sinless and the spotless Lamb of God would become sin for us. That was something that was far more terrible to bear than just the excruciating pain of a nail in your hand, or a spear in your side, or struggling to gasp for air. to become sin. That was awful. And then it's so interesting that he says in our text, he says a reproach in verse 20 of chapter 69, he says, "Reproach hath broken my heart. I'm full of heaviness. And I look for some to take pity, but there was none. And for comforters, but I found none." He says, "Reproach hath broken my heart." I'm sure you've heard of cases where people have been married for a long, long time, and the one partner dies, the husband perhaps dies, or the wife dies, and then a short period of time after that, the surviving spouse also dies, sometimes within hours, sometimes within weeks. And you think, that's amazing how they would die in such a short space of time. I suspect that when I die, Trace will go for years without having to die straight away. But, you know, sometimes you hear of people they love one another so much that it just seems that the death has actually affected the surviving spouse. And you could say that in such a case that the person, and you've heard this phrase before, that person has died of a broken heart. You've heard of that kind of a phrase. And years ago, this is something that would have been mocked at and scoffed at. But just recently, medical science has become to understand something about a person that has a broken heart. And so both the British Heart Association and the American Heart Association, if you look at their website, it tells us of a condition that is, it's stress-induced, and it's a stress-induced cardiomyopathy. Now, these are words that are just too big for me to pronounce. I kind of have to break them up in my mind before I even say them. But it's a stress-induced cardiomyopathy. And it's also known as Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. And the... How would you pronounce it?
No.
You're just talking about... laughing at my pronunciation. So those are the big words for it, a stress-induced cardiomyopathy. But for ordinary people like you and I, it's known as a broken heart syndrome. And so when you think of a broken heart, sometimes I say to Tracy, and I really do love you, Tracy, then you kind of think of a heart that's kind of broken, don't you? You've seen those cartoon characters where there's a heart and it's kind of like jagged in between, and so the person, the boyfriend or the girlfriend's broken their heart. And you can kind of get the picture. But you know that a person who has gone through a time of terrible stress can have a broken heart. And it actually has real life physical consequences where it can actually give a person the same kind of symptoms as what an actual heart attack might have. They might feel that. You know, they might have the pain of angina coming on and the tightness of the chest. And all of this is related to what is, we would term as a broken heart syndrome. And it's interesting that Jesus is spoken of in Psalm 69, where he says that reproach hath broken my heart. And five times we see that word reproach being used in this particular psalm. In verse 20 he says, "Reproach hath broken my heart, and I'm full of heaviness." If you'd like to go back to chapter 22 of Psalms, Psalms 22. We'll look at this psalm in a bit more detail in a few moments' time, but this again is also very much a messianic psalm in nature. But look in verse 14, he says, "I'm poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint, and my heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. Reproach," he says, "hath broken my heart." What I'd like us to do tonight is to consider just how this reproach had broken our Saviour's heart as we think about Calvary tonight. When you think about this time of the year, there are three particular places that come to our attention. The first is Gethsemane, the second is Gabbatha, and the third is Golgotha. And isn't it great that they all start with G, so that my points can all be beginning with a G tonight. But I'd like us to consider these three places in relation to our Saviour having had reproach broke his heart. Let's firstly go to the New Testament and let's look at Gethsemane. If you'd like to go to Matthew and chapter 26 and verse 36. Matthew chapter 26, verse 36. We're all familiar with the scenes of Gethsemane. Gethsemane is one of those places that seems to be quite sacred, if you like, in the life of our Saviour. It would seem to me that Christ would go to this Garden of Gethsemane perhaps more there than anywhere else. We often read of him going to this place, spending time with his Heavenly Father in prayer. But let's look at verse 36 of Matthew 26. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, Sit ye here, while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto his disciples, finding them asleep, and saith unto Peter, What, could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. He came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. And he left them, went away again, and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then cometh he to his disciples, and saith unto them, Sleep on now, and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. Behold, he is at hand that doth betray me. So here we have a picture of our Saviour in Gethsemane. And we see as to how he withdraws from Peter and James and John. They seem to be the three disciples that formed the inner circle. They always are associated with quite intimate acts of our Saviour. The other disciples are perhaps a bit further away, but Peter, James, and John had gone up with him to pray. But then he leaves them and he goes about a stone's throw away from them and he goes to his Father in prayer. And the scene that you have before you is one of our Saviour as he is contemplating all that he is going to endure as he goes to the cross. And you can well imagine that in the Garden of Gethsemane, that the devil would have been doing what he could to try and hinder the work of our Saviour. We read in one of the other gospel accounts as to how the angels came and ministered to Christ at this time of great need. And it would seem that he was being terribly assaulted by all the powers of darkness as he contemplated going to the cross for our sins. The thing that disturbed him wasn't so much the fear of physical death, because he's God and he knew that he would rise again from the dead. It wasn't the fear of the pain, because that would just be but passing. It wasn't even the fear of the terrible death of the cross. But the thing that would crush our Saviour's heart would be the very thought, the very anticipation of the fact that he would bear the sins of the whole world, and just think that he is God, he is the holy and the harmless and the spotless Lamb of God, and he's going to be taking sin upon himself. Now, we might think that we have a bit of an understanding about the sinfulness of sin, but really we have not even scratched the surface in comparison to how God looks upon sin. And never there was a man quite like our Savior who could see sin for all that it really was. And he was about to take that sin upon himself. And he's anticipating this great and awful burden that he was about to bear. He knew what it would cost. And it was something that was too awful to even consider. And it's no wonder that the Bible says that he began to be very heavy. But we do read in the Gospel of Luke, and we know Luke is a medical doctor, and so he gives a description as to what our Savior goes through that the other gospel accounts don't actually bring to our attention. Because this broken heart syndrome is actually a condition that can cause a person to be so distressed that they'll actually physically begin to sweat droplets of blood. And this is what he says in Luke chapter 22 and verse 44. The Bible says that he was in agony as he prayed more earnestly. And his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling to the ground. Now you think about this, that our Savior is so anticipating Calvary and anticipating the horrors and the awfulness of him becoming sin for us, and reproach is breaking his heart in two, that he's sweating these sweat droplets from his body. The prospect of what he is about to endure is breaking his heart. And then we leave Gethsemane and we go to another place called Gabbatha. Look, if you would, in John chapter 19. And we'll read from verse 1. John chapter 19, the Bible says that Pilate took Jesus and scourged him, and the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they put on him a purple robe and said, "Hail, King of the Jews," and they smote him with their hands. Pilate therefore went forth again and saith unto them, "Behold, I bring him forth to you, that you may know that I find no fault in him." Then came Jesus forth wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate saith unto them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests therefore and officers saw him, they cried out, saying, "Crucify him, crucify him." Pilate saith unto them, "Take ye him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and by our law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God." When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he was the more afraid. He went again into the judgment hall and saith unto Jesus, "Whence art thou?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Then saith Pilate unto him, "Speakest thou not unto me? Knowest thou not that I have power to crucify thee and have power to release thee?" Jesus answered, "Thou couldst have no power at all against me, except it were given thee from above. Therefore he that delivered me unto thee hath the greater sin." And from thenceforth Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, saying, "If thou let this man go, thou art not Caesar's friend. Whoso maketh himself a king speaketh against Caesar." When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus forth and sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the pavement, but in the Hebrew, Gabbatha. And it was the preparation of the Passover, and about the sixth hour. And he saith unto the Jews, "Behold your king." But they cried out, "Away with him, away with him, crucify him." Pilate saith unto them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." Then delivered he him therefore unto them to be crucified. And they took Jesus and led him away. So here we read of Christ being at Pilate's judgment hall. The Bible says the place of the pavement, a place called Gabbatha. He's been betrayed by his own familiar friend. You can imagine the pain that that would bring. We read as to how before Pilate that he would be scourged, led away to be scourged. And in fact, that scourging was so awful. And we know the way that they would beat a person was just too horrible as to how sometimes a person could literally die from being scourged. But Psalms 129 gives us a bit of an indication. In 129 verse 3, the Bible says, "The plowers plowed upon my back, and they made long their furrows." That's the kind of depiction that you have of the scourging that our Savior would have received. He's mocked by the soldiers. They take that awful crown of thorns and they ram it down upon his head. Isaiah tells us that they pluck the beard of his face. And we read lastly that he's taken and condemned to die. But our Lord's reproach, the thing that was breaking his heart, was not over yet. Here he was being treated most wickedly against those that are most definitely the enemies of our Savior. Gethsemane, he's anticipating the horrors of the cross. In Gabbatha, he's been afflicted by the enemies of the cross. And it takes us up to Golgotha. If you just look down at verse 17 and 18, you know, John chapter 19, the Bible says, "And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of a skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him, and two other with him, on either side one, and Jesus in the midst." These verses speak about the climax of our Savior's obedience, and of course, indeed, the climax of his awful sorrow. And here he is. Reproach is breaking his heart. He's been betrayed by Judas. He's been denied by Peter. He's essentially been forsaken by all. And to just die an awful, lonely death between two thieves. But that wasn't bad enough, because we also read in the Word of God as to he also would be abandoned by the Father. I'd like you to turn back to Psalms 22, if you would. Psalms 22. When you read a psalm like this, it's you would think to yourself, why, how can it be that a Jew could read the Psalms and not be able to say, look at this, this surely is speaking about the Savior here. But this, we won't read all of the psalm. I'm just going to point out some of the verses to you. Look at verse 1. He says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? Verse 6, I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men and despised of the people. Verse 14, I'm poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. Verse 16, for dogs have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. He's just, the psalmist is just, he can only be speaking about the Savior. And as Jesus is upon the cross and as the nails have been driven into his hands and his feet, and these Gentile dogs essentially are gathered round about him, and they're mocking him and jeering and cursing at him. But through the midst of it all, God the Father had to turn his face from God the Son. As Jesus became sin for us, God, who is of pure eyes to behold iniquity, had to remove his face and stop looking and stop having a time a time where there'd never been separation between any member of the Godhead. He just had to turn his face, and Jesus would cry out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? We look at Psalms 40, if you just go over a couple more chapters, Psalms number 40, and look down at verse 12. He says, innumerable evils have compassed me about. Mine iniquities have taken hold upon me, so that I'm not able to look up. They are more than the hairs of mine head. Therefore my heart faileth. And then if you can turn over just a few books to the book of Lamentations, in chapter number 1 and verse 12. Lamentations, chapter 1 and verse 12. Is it nothing to you, all ye that pass by? Behold and see if there be any sorrow like unto my sorrow, which is done unto me, wherewith the Lord hath afflicted me in the day of his fierce anger. If there be any sorrow like unto my sorrow. Why this agony? Why this reproach? Why this broken heart? It's just quite simply because he became sin for us. And this is what Paul says in the book of 2 Corinthians, that he says in chapter 5, for he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. He became sin for us. Reproach hath broken my heart. Now, of course, Jesus did not die of a broken heart. He dismissed his spirit. He said, it is finished, and he gave up the ghost. But it was a triumphant cry as he dismissed his spirit, because even though he's there hanging upon a cursed tree, and even though he's hanging there as an individual, God in the flesh, who has become a curse for us, he is going to die in complete triumph over sin. And this is what Paul says in the book of Colossians, chapter 2 and verse 14. You don't need to turn there. But he says, blotting out the handwriting of ordinance that was against us, that was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. It was a triumphant cry as he died upon the cross. And that Colossians goes on to say in verse 15, having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. And so we look at these scenes tonight, and as our minds go back to Calvary, we must say, hallelujah, what a Savior, that he would so love us. Reproach hath broken my heart. In Gethsemane, our dear Redeemer there is facing and anticipating the cross, anticipating what he would become for us, full of heaviness, and reproach, he's breaking his heart. And in Gabbatha, as he suffers at the hands of cruel, wicked men, again, he utters no cry to defense. Reproach is breaking his heart. And then ultimately on the cross at Golgotha, as the Father turns his face from the Son, and as the Son bears the sins for the whole world, reproach breaks his heart. Gives up the ghost, and he pays the penalty for our sin in full. And so we thank God for such a wonderful Savior such as he tonight. And we're thankful that the story doesn't end with Calvary, doesn't it? We're thankful that the story ends with the empty tomb. Jesus would be taken down, would be placed in the tomb, and 3 days later he would rise from the grave triumphant. And we indeed thank God for such a Saviour as he. May the Lord bless you as you think about these things this time of the year, as we consider what Christ has done for us. Amen.